Well, that works.
All right. Well, hi, everyone, and welcome. There is a lot of changes that are happening, so bear with us if there's any tech issues today. We got a new green screen. We got a new computer. Are we good?
We're good.
All
right. Yeah. Let us know if the volume's okay. Again?
Yeah, definitely let us know if the volume's working, because you plugged this in, not to, like, the computer speaker thing, right?
Correct, yes.
Yeah, my knowledge of tech stuff is so limited, I have to try to use my words as simply as possible for Josh to understand my caveman understanding of it. But hi, everyone. We are officially going to get started in like 5 minutes. We're just going to make sure the volume and everything is working on your guys' end. If you have any questions during this entire stream, please just put at vonnart, and we will be sure to check it since we have Josh here as the mod. We'll do the formal introductions, though, in a little bit. So before we get started, I'm letting you guys know we have a new schedule for 2022. We're going to be streaming every Wednesday again, like we used to. And every stream is going to be focused in this mermaid card deck. And I'll explain what that is, why I'm doing that. And we're pretty excited to get back into it. I think we found a lot of joy in doing things from home rather than having to go to a convention every other week. And I think COVID was a weird blessing in disguise for us, where we realized we maybe don't have to do 20 plus conventions a year. We can be more at home. We can be doing things around the house more, or doing things like streaming or things with Instagram reels and pre-recorded content. So I think I'm going to try to focus more on that. And Josh, thankfully, is here to help along the way, because I would be not too well on my own if I was to do all this tech stuff by myself. So that is what we are looking at. And I guess if there's any other issues you guys notice while the stream's happening, just please let us know, especially with the audio. I feel like that's the one I'm always, like, weird about. And our new computer that we got, it's a little loud for my comfort. It's not a Mac. I'm doing everything in my power to understand PCs, but I'm definitely a simple-minded person when it comes to technology, as I keep repeating. So please let us know if the audio works, and Josh will get to it. Okay, the next thing is, I have two books that I have gotten the past 2 weeks that I want to show off. The first one, I have to do it like this, don't I?
Yeah.
The first one was from, I was going to like show it under the camera here. First one was from Miles Johnson, or Miles Art on Instagram. It's his ink sketchbook that he did in collaboration with a gallery that he did. So it's not his full pencil or oil stuff, but it's a good collection of his work. And it was a nice surprise to get in the mail. He's a wonderful artist. I think he's one of the best living graphite artists alive today. So if you're interested, I would definitely check that out. And then Josh got me this giant Final Fantasy VII.
Merry Christmas.
It's kind of like a, what was it? Like a compilation of a few things, like artwork and then behind the scenes stuff.
Kind of some of the, yeah, making the actual.
So it definitely has like a lot of the 3D model stuff, which is fine. I actually do enjoy the close-up shots of it, but what I'm really interested in, let me see where the concept stuff is. So it does the concepts of all the characters, and some of the drawings are from Tetsuya, but a lot of them are from a different artist I'm not even aware of. But you can always tell the difference between, I know it's kind of hard to see on the camera, but like a Tetsuya drawing and a non-Tetsuya drawing. Still good though, and I like that they give little notes about each character. So I'm definitely excited to give this a look through, and I'll give you a full review of it, hopefully by next week. So thank you again, Josh, for that.
Of course. It is fun to look through. They even have like soundtrack stuff in there, which is kind of cool.
Let's see. Oh, the next thing, we do have our YouTube subscriber back on. So Josh, if you want to show the emotes, we're going to have that available to you guys during the chat. We have these custom emojis that Ella, one of our wonderful mods, made and is continuing to roll out. I think we have quite a few more left to go. So right now, it kind of looks pretty self-indulgent because they're all of me, but I promise there's more coming of the cats, of Josh, and some other little fun surprises. And you can get that for subscribing to YouTube and then doing the member. We also are, I'm totally revamping the Patreon because of this new schedule that I've been on. And I'll talk about this a little bit when the stream actually gets going. But being on a schedule has helped me so much. And there's three main projects that I'm kind of like zooming in and laser focusing on. So all my Patreon backers get to see the progress on those three projects. And that would be this card deck, so kind of the thing I'm working on today, the tarot cards, which will be probably another 5 years to go if I'm completely honest with you guys, But every card along the way, I'm going to take screenshots and progress picks and then talk about all the elements of each card. And that will be one of the things that I keep updating on Patreon. And the last one is my 5-foot Aquatica Nautica that I have been doing a lot of reels on Instagram for recently. I'm doing 1 hour on that every single workday. So you can look forward to those updates. And I try to post pretty much every day, if not all three of the updates, because I try to do an hour on each daily. Definitely one or two, and then I'll do like an update the next day with like 2 or 3 hours worth of progress.
Tim's always in a better mood when he has a schedule.
And yeah.
You've been sticking to it, which has been good.
Which is, I think, something I want to talk about during the stream on how much I didn't realize I needed it. And, you know, sometimes I have this more hippie mindset of, oh, I like to be free with my schedule and not be limited by what I can do and access during the day. But honestly, I feel so much better having a routine. And we'll talk about that when the stream gets started. All right, last two things I wrote down are these streams that we're bringing back, they're meant to be community focused. So please ask questions. This is supposed to be a dialogue, not just me rambling and then Josh trying to manage it for 2 hours. That will be kind of the goal for this year, is to create more of a Discord between us. And especially if you guys have any questions on making a card deck, I really do implore any artist to make one. They really did save us through 2020. And I'll explain more on why I made the first card deck, my Royals deck, and why I'm doing another one now. So please ask questions, but please put at vonnart. I already see some familiar faces. Hello, hello, yeah. Everyone.
Amy, Alex is here. Felix is here.
Hey, fam, of course.
Oh, yes.
Oscar and Alex Dos Diaz, the wonderful, the one and only. Okay. And I think... yep, that's all I got. Okay, so you ready to officially get started?
Let's do it. iPad's been hit or miss with, sometimes it will...
we'll move this over.
Blue screen on us right now, but...
If the iPad does zonk out, we'll just... it's like a 30-second fix, and we'll make sure it comes back. Okay, so officially... hi, everyone. I'm Timothy Von Rueden, better known as Vonnart Online, and I'm joined by my co-host, Josh, as he will be our lovely mod. And today we are going to be working on the Jack of Clubs, but more specifically, I'm going to give more of a broad sense of understanding for you guys if you want to know how to make your own card deck, the process to do it, why I use Procreate to start with the thumbnails, and how easy it is to start in it, and we'll kind of go from there. So, to start off, I keep wanting to do the camera down here. But to start off, I made a card deck in... oh, why is there such a delay? Wait, no, do it on the other one.
Is that too much? Okay.
That's way too much. Okay.
There you go.
I made a card deck last year, and as you can see, all the face cards. I was going to make a Wumbo deck. That's why I printed them bigger, and I ended up not doing it. But now I kind of regret not making a Wumbo deck and have, like, huge cards. But I did a card deck because it was something I wanted to do since, like, 2018, but I never had the right time frame to fit it in my schedule because it was too big of a project to fit in with what I was doing at the time. And then when COVID struck and we kind of had this huge exterior house bill that we had to pay, I had to zoom in and laser focus on a project that I knew would do, you know, decent enough. I didn't expect it to do as well as it did, but decent enough to help pay for the expenses and also help get us through this uncertain time of not having conventions. And what took me about 3.5 months, I started in like late January, February, and then I finished in about, I think it was like early April, and then I ran a Kickstarter for it right away. And that's where the first card deck came from. And I'm telling you guys, if you are an artist, and you're like, you're looking to be more financially secure, this has been the best seller since we released it on the shop since, what, it was like August 2020?
Yeah.
So literally a year and a half, and I'm sure it'll continue to be the best seller for a while too. And this overrides my books, my prints, totes, everything. So if you are an artist, I promise it doesn't take too much time. It's 12 face cards, 2 jokers if you want to, and then like the ace cards. And that's only if you want to do the extra step and make, you know, special aces.
Well, when we learned too, there are people that just collect card decks. There's like a whole community that we had no idea with card decks.
There's a huge community of card deck people. And we're learning that they're very specific on the card type, the card brand, the company that you get printed with. So we're actually partnering with Bicycle for the next one because we found out that's like a big deal is you don't partner with Bicycle to make your cards.
There's lingo for the type of card there is even too. I forget the, it's like MGP. There's all the different.
Oh, yeah.
People have their different card stock that they're very serious about.
Yeah. So I've definitely learned a lot since then, and I can continue to share it on these streams if you guys have any questions. But that is what I wanted to start off the stream with. And also that, yes, Patreons will get access to every single daily piece that I'm working on. So, like, this is the Jack of Clubs, but I have, I think, five others that I have pretty much lined out. And those I post usually daily as well. But today we're going to be working on the Jack of Clubs. The next thing I want to talk about is the Mermaid card deck idea. Yes, so where did this idea even come from, and why am I forcing this into 2022? Because I've wanted to do this ever since I had the idea of doing a card deck. I think I did the Royals one because I was testing the water, and since it did pretty well, I've always wanted to do a card deck with mermaids where their tails are interlooping and intersecting, and it creates this cool visual of this kind of flowy illustration. So this is really the card deck I wanted to make. And for each card deck, I think that I make moving forward, there needs to be a purpose behind it. I don't want to just be a card deck maker because it's financially sound. I have to actually be excited about the project. And I don't think I was excited about the mermaids until literally mid-December. And the reason was late last year was really rough for me artistically. Drawtober was, it was fine, but for me personally, it felt like a failure. It still gained followers on the actual Instagram, but myself, my personal one, I was losing followers when I would post my Drawtober submissions. And I was putting a lot of effort into building actual structures and like doing a fire one. I had a lot of these big ideas, and the fact that they weren't being received well, I thought I was over needing social validation, but clearly I needed another like internal kind of perspective shift, because it was bothering me, and Josh had to deal with it. And I think it took me like even till the end of November, early December, of things still not picking up, for me to just be like broke. I felt I had no other direction to go in, and I started doing like heavy powder graphite, and I was experimenting more. And then literally it was like as I finished one of the really dark pencil drawing that I did, I realized how much storytelling needs to be an element in my work, because I don't get excited about my work if there's no storytelling aspect to it. And then a step further, not only does storytelling, I feel, add a layer of what I need my work to say, it's the relationships. And not just the relationships of like a character holding an object and their relationship with the object, but like the arm's relationship to the body. Is it darker in value? Is there a contrast there? And if I'm using a mid-tone for the body, I need the hands and the hair maybe to be a darker or lighter tone. And that relationship within the whole piece needs to melt together seamlessly. And I found out that relationships and storytelling are kind of my focus moving forward, because I think that's why I got into art a long time ago, because I was trying to connect to people. But also what I was creating, I felt every time I created something, I would create these little stories behind everything I would create. And I think throughout 2021, I was stumbling, trying to figure out, why am I not liking my work? Why am I finding this disconnect? And it was because I personally wasn't putting myself in it. I was putting like this barrier of the artwork, and I thought that the technical kind of aspect would speak for itself, and I wouldn't need to put my own voice within it because it was rendered really pretty, or it has all the right things to add into a piece to make it appeal to people. But it wasn't appealing to me. And it took me literally like 9 months to hit that realization of, duh, I need that for me to want to even make my work. Otherwise, what was it worth? It's, you know, it's hollow. And I don't ever want my work feeling hollow again.
I mean, you as a person are a storyteller, so it only makes sense that you need to make sure your art's doing that too.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
I think it was hard for me to grasp that, because I think when you call yourself a storyteller, then people like immediately want these like super well-written stories. But I started to realize maybe it's like little ones that I can touch on. It doesn't have to be like this grand, well-written proverb, but you know, the little story of like my little puppet carving another tree to make a puppet friend of his own. Like little stories like that, I really enjoy. And I think short stories are where I might focus on. And maybe that's where my strength lies. I don't know. I got to explore this more. So anyways, moving on to the mermaid deck, I'm pulling my story of how last year was such a disaster for me in terms of artistically. Because like personally, we were good. The house was fine. Like personally, I'm actually doing great. But I try to separate my life into like personal Tim and vonnart Tim.
I still don't understand that, but
it's a weird separation. Really
compartmentalized. He really does that though.
I
don't understand.
I think it's the only way I can function properly in this world. But I know for Josh, it's really confusing because if I'm feeling really down artistically, but I'm doing great in my life, he doesn't understand the disconnect of like, why are you so bummed then when you go to work if you're having such a great life? But to me, there's definitely a clear separation and divide.
Fair enough.
But I'm bringing that story of why last year was so bad for me into this card deck. And the story that I'm doing for each of them... Oh, you can't see this either. But I guess my patrons can see better views of this. I've been drawing these little sketches and doodles of each family. And the idea is that there was some kind of, mind you, I'm talking now fantastically, in this underwater story that I'm creating with the card deck, there was some kind of a disaster. I still don't know what that is. I don't know if it's like a plague, a war, an oil spill, a poison, whatever it might be. But I'm having each of the families represented by the suits be heavily affected by whatever this tragedy was. So the hearts, I have a king and his two twins, and they lost their mother. So the queen would actually be the girl twin, and then the boy would be the jack. And I'll kind of go through each of what I'm thinking for them. I feel like I'm going to tangent a little bit here. So honestly, if you guys have any questions, please interrupt, because I can go for a while if I don't interrupt.
Jolly Jawbreaker, happy new year to you too.
Oh, well, happy 2022. I hope it's a good one and prosperous for all of you guys, because I know I'm coming into the year strong.
You're ready.
I want to give some of that energy to you guys, too.
After your December.
Well, mid-December, I started getting better.
Oh, yeah, and Fem, good point, too. There's the community Discord, which is linked below also. And that's a good one, too. Everyone's on there. It's a good place just to critique each other, talk about your work, get some ideas from other people. Amy, those big cards are so cool.
The Wumbo
things.
I do want to make a Wumbo deck again.
We really should play with these sometime just to try it out.
What's funny is these I just cut by hand and I edged the, I gold gilded the edges myself. So if we made a proper one, it would be pretty cool.
We probably could.
Like play with a big deck. It'd be funny to play multiplayer solitaire with these because they're so big.
That'd be obnoxious. Felix, I'm trying out painting on my new tablet properly for the first time. I'm using Krita, and it feels a little unusual, but let's see what I can do in 2 hours. Happy to have you here, Felix.
Felix, it's always good to see you. I know I want to do another follow-along eventually because I felt like I really got to understand and know you guys better through your work and your submission. So I definitely want to do that again because that's how we found your work, Felix, and you definitely were a standout for me.
Alex says, Melinda says, you weren't losing followers, but tailoring your audience.
Yes. I felt like I was... I hate using the word scared, because I don't usually use that word to associate with myself, but I felt like I was scared of really diving into personal work, and I felt like 2020 really shook me up, and it was weird putting myself in a position of, like, wanting attention or like look at me, especially through everything that went down in 2020. It took me a while to realize like I can still spread joy and happiness through my work, and I don't need to like have this weird barrier between the two. And I think I'm finally getting back to it. It took me a year to find my footing again, but I think we're here again. But I do agree.
I mean, this is still, when you think about it, the first digital age for artists, that like these Instagram and things, it's not been a trail that's been tread much, so it's something that's still new for a lot of people.
Social media.
And you, it's like you're trying to make your work, but then you also have this looming follower count and those things that make, I don't know, they're part of your career.
I mean, social media really changed the game up, because when I went to school, the only thing we really had was DeviantArt, kind of. And it wasn't like a place where you got a lot of social gain, because at that time, everyone just assumed you would get a job in the industry. So, like, that was the end goal. And literally, the past 15 years, it, like, completely got shooken up of what you can do as an artist. I think with the addition of not only streaming platforms, but definitely Patreon, Kickstarter was huge. And conventions really, like, started really picking up. So you have all these different avenues out of nowhere for artists to start making a comfortable revenue income. And no longer is the goal to work at a studio, but to, like, work for yourself. And I feel like I was born at, like, the perfect time where I could navigate through that and then have a full-time job for a little while that I actually enjoyed teaching with CG Cookie, and then do conventions on the side to test the waters. And then as it started doing better and better, I was able to make a transition with a more comfortable landing pad than I think for others it can be a little harder. So hopefully, you know, things like these videos and questions that you ask or other resources that you can find online can make that jump or that transition easier for yourself if you're trying to do the same. Actually, I know even with Alex, who's in the chat, he's trying to make that transition from having like a full-time, he's full-time freelance, and to have it be more of like just personal work sustaining himself. And yeah, that's something that is very doable in today's day and age. And social media plays a big part in that. Those are the positives. I'll do the negatives really quick and I'll get back to the mermaid deck. The negatives are, though, I think we create this terrible projection for ourselves, or trajection, I should say, of what we should be creating, how we create it, and we put a lot of our value and worth in terms of social validation and gain. So if you post a drawing and it underperforms your average, you'll almost unintentionally and subconsciously view that piece as a lesser piece. Even if it meant something a lot to you, and while you're creating it, you could now see it as a bad piece. And the only ones that then we give attention to are the ones that do get a good response socially, and we want to create more of that. But then in that way, we're just responding and creating for, we're like catering what we create for Instagram, which I don't believe is too healthy. And I went through that last year, and I found out why eventually your art just feels hollow. And I think we can name, I'm not going to name names, but I think when I see a lot of artists that their work does feel a little hollow, I can see that they just want to make money. And it's not a bad thing. I think every artist goes through that phase or a couple of phases in their career where they're more financial focused. And I think as long as you're recognizing that you're in that stage and that eventually you want to move out, I think that's the best way to continue making true art. But also, this is a very opinionated statement. But I believe the best art, I always say, is a marriage between technical merit, creativity, and then right down the center is like your uniqueness and what you bring to the piece. And like the point at which all three meet, I believe, is the best art. And I know that art is subjective and all that other stuff, but I believe I can judge a piece on those three factors. And usually when I see artists, it's they're usually doing a lot of one of the three, but not all three. And oh, hello, Astrid.
Hi, Astrid.
Wow, our first stream in, we already have Astrid wanting to join in.
Joe, come say hi to everybody.
Hey, baby girl.
Come say hello.
Oh, baby.
Goodness. Just a little moment with Astrid.
So this is Astrid the cat. She's our original cat, and she is also going to get an emoji done soon. She's more of like the princess of the house.
Oh my gosh, yes. Do you want to just lay down?
What's loves up? Napping, loves getting attention.
Okay. She's gone.
And then eventually you'll meet our other cat, Casper, who's our like black, rough cat. And he's very much like me, and then Astrid's very much like Josh. So it's very funny that our two cats very much corresponded to who we are.
Sucked up our personalities.
Okay, I'll move back to the mermaid deck, or else I'm going to keep rambling about social media forever.
Well, the story. The stories of them, yes.
Okay. So the hearts are with the dad who lost his wife, and he has these two kids. And I want them to be roughly like 14, 15, so like too young to really be on their own. But I need the girl to kind of step up in the position of the queen, even though she's not ready. And then the son, not jealous, but is definitely the one that's kind of like left over because now the dad has spent a lot of time with the daughter. So they're going to lose their mom. And then with the clubs, oh, and each suit, I'm kind of representing certain aspects of them based on the ocean that I pair with them. So the hearts, I'm doing Pacific. And then I'll find like little tidbits. But if you guys have any other suggestions or tips on ocean, if any of you are like marine biologists out there watching, let us know. Because right now I wrote down things like it's the largest ocean. Pacific actually means peaceful, which I did not know. And it has the most volcanoes and in the most islands. So I wanted to pull more of that type of imagery into the way that I draw them as well. And it all it takes are like little adjectives or little notes for me to then arrange their bodies or their fins or their tails slightly different from one another. But every tail, I want to look, as you can kind of see with our club, the tail looks like a club. I want a lot of these little alluding to the suit that they're from without it being super obvious. And then even his, I don't have it on here, but the scales for each mermaid, I'm going to do a slight variation of the pip. So for him, they're going to, you can kind of see it here. They're going to be a little loosely based on the club with the three. And then he's holding a wreath that has a lot of this kelpy seaweed. And then there's going to be three black berries throughout it. And I like the idea of the club kingdom having a lot of this kelp that has these three black berries on them. And that's where the pip came from in their kingdom. So speaking of the clubs, I'm basing this off the Indian Ocean. And it is the warmest ocean. And I'm basing a lot of things like the clown betta fish or the trigger fish. And a lot of fish that are more flowy and finny. I wrote down betta fish, not because they actually live in that part, but I love the over-exaggeration flowiness. It's like fabric and water. And I want to create a lot of that illusion with them, especially since the club shape itself has so much curvature and back and forths to it. I want to kind of mirror that through this. And the story between them is they lost their father. And the mother is now having the son step up. So different than the hearts, because the hearts are like younger twins. In this case, the clubs, they're much older. So these two brothers, and the older brother is stepping up to be kind of the leader of the war faction. And the younger brother, which I'm doing here, is the one to step up as like the social advisor. And he's definitely more of the hippy dippy one, and the brother's more of like the serious strong one, but they get along great. So it's not like this feuding faction within them. The next ones are the diamonds. Oh, and something else I should note is I'm very much utilizing value with their skin tone as well. So since the club is a black, I'm having the tail be black on. Let me create a new layer really quick. So I'm going to probably have, I'll probably have the tail be darker like this to kind of give the illusion of the club, and then it'll fade as it goes up the tail. Where's my direction? Oh, here. I have it very loopy. And then as it gets to his body will be more pale, so it creates that nice contrast between the two. But then I'm doing the opposite for the hearts and the diamonds. So for the hearts, I guess I can show you the...
Because you're not going to use red on these ones either, right?
No, which I know a lot of people may not be super happy with that, but I think I'm going to stay true to my work and my style of just using grayscale and then gold for accents. But then for the hearts, kind of you can see the same thing with her tail. You see the illusion of the heart, but also she's going to be a very dark-skinned mermaid, and then I'm going to transition her skin tone into a lighter one as it gets to her tail, which is almost absent of any shading. And that's kind of what I want to do for the black and red pips of the series. So if it's a red pip, it'll probably be a darker skinned mermaid. And that's what I'm doing with the diamonds, but I won't show you those. I got to save some of the stuff for my Patreon backers. But essentially, I can give you a quick glimpse at the three of them. I know it's probably hard to see. But essentially, this one, he lost his wife, and then they only had one kid, a son, and then he has been recently engaged. So the main king will be the king, and then his son will be the jack, and then his fiance, or his wife, I still haven't decided, will be the queen. And then the final one are the spades, the evil family, the one that I always enjoy working on, because I always like rooting for the villains, as Josh knows from watching the recent season of Cobra Kai. It was my favorite one yet. It's definitely a guilty pleasure. I wouldn't say it's like great writing or anything, but it, for some reason, it hits me in my core and I love it.
Tim wants to be Ursula.
If I was in drag, I wouldn't say she's like my number one villain. I would say Maleficent is up there for sure. And number one villain. I'd have to really think about that for a second. Maleficent's definitely up there, though. She's just like... I don't even know the right word.
She's kind of glamorous.
She exuded just malice to me. Like, she did all of this because she wasn't invited to a... whatever it was
for
the baby. No.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, and she was so bitter. She did all this stuff. Yeah, anyways, love Melissa. But the Spade family, both of the parents died, and they had three children, two sons and a daughter. And all three of them can't stand each other, and each of them want to be the king. So the way that I'm going to work this one up, because every king I'm going to be having holding some kind of a staff or a spear or some kind of a long pole weapon, and I'm going to actually give it to the youngest son. So the son, who's going to be kind of the younger, angsty one, he's going to be the king. And then I'm going to have the Jack be this, like, anime-type villain. Think Sephiroth meets an anime villain. I'm going for, like, super, like, who's the Inuyasha villain? I don't even think he's the main villain. He's the long, white-haired one. That's who I'm going to make the Jack. And then the daughter, I still haven't figured out my exact reference, but she's also going to be very, like, powerful, kind of intimidatingly powerful when at first glance. So those are going to be the Spade family. So they'll be kind of fun. Definitely the most malicious out of the four. So those are the stories that I'm doing for each of them. Oh, and yeah, the Spades are based on, sorry, the Arctic Ocean / Southern, because I found out there's technically five, not four oceans.
Oh.
I did not learn that in school.
Wait, it's called the Southern Ocean?
Yeah. So the southernmost, I know.
What?
Yeah. No. See, you didn't know it either.
So there's five.
Yeah, Google it. I was so thrown off. I was like, wait, I thought there were only four. See?
Most countries now, including the United States, recognize the Southern Antarctic as the fifth ocean.
See? And apparently it does a lot with temperature.
But where is it? So it's just the would that be part of the Southern Hemisphere?
Like this whole bottom.
Oh, weird.
Right?
Aren't those just ice fields anyways? I don't know. Well,
anyways, so I'm basically, well, the Arctic Ocean is basically the North Ocean, and then the Southern Ocean is the Southern Ocean.
Okay, but that would be Antarctica, the Southern Ocean.
Antarctica is a continent.
Well, yeah, but that's where Antarctica is.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got you.
So I'm basing the Spades off of those two oceans, and it's these feuding siblings that I'm going for very cold. So that's why I chose these oceans to represent them. So I'm going to do, like, super pale skin and then, like, super blacks for their tails and a lot of spikes, a lot of malice-looking tail fins. And the things I wrote down were whales and webbing, but I definitely want to include more, like, spiky, almost like, I might go for, what's it called, super deep ocean? What's that trench called? The marina? It's the super deep trench. Anyways, I'm going to look up fish and aquatic life in those areas to kind of inspire the visuals for these mermaids. Okay. So now that is...
Mariana Trench.
Mariana Trench.
That's right.
So I want to look up a lot of the creatures down there. I mean, it's so fascinating. If you just Google Mariana Trench creatures, you'll find some really weird things. So... before I start actually getting to the drawing, I know what I've been talking for a half hour straight. Let me just show you really quick.
Nothing new.
How to do this on Procreate. So if you have an iPad, Procreate is definitely the, I would say, app of choice of many artists nowadays. But the reason it's so nice, let me duplicate this really quick so you can see. So... they have a mirror and mirror flip in Procreate built in. So when you draw up here, It'll also draw down, and it'll mirror it. So if I draw on the left side, you see how it's mirrored here. And what's so nice about that is every card that I want to create, and most traditional card decks have the mirror flip. So to do that, all you do, actually now I got to find it again. I believe it is here. So you go to the wrench. I don't even think you guys can see this. Oh no.
I can.
That's okay. No, that's okay.
Okay. Because I can make us go invisible for a sec.
Okay, go invisible for a sec.
Okay. There we go.
Transition.
Oh my gosh, I forgot to do that.
All right, so if you choose the gear, you can't see the gear on the screen, but right under the gear, it opens up this action panel, and then you go to drawing guide, edit drawing guide.
Hello, I'm here for the geography lesson with Tim and Josh. Geography lesson sponsored by Google.
Wait,
no, you actually know your geography pretty good though.
I would not put that on.
Well, you research the stuff, at least you know it.
I
forgot about the trench. That was like grade school.
No, what is this? Yeah, you choose symmetry. There we go. And then options.
Oh, wait, that doesn't show up in there.
No, it does. Remember, there's a delay.
No, it doesn't show the bottom panel, though, that you're using.
That's okay. There is a battle panel that pulls up. You just choose options, and then you choose horizontal. So then when you click done, and then when you're in here, see how it does that? And that's it. So one more time, if you guys missed it, you click on the wrench, you choose edit drawing guide, and then on the bottom, when the screen pulls up, there'll be a symmetry option. Then you click options and make sure you choose horizontal. And then there should be a rotational symmetry as well. Make sure you have that turned on. Click done. And there you go.
Gorgeous.
So now I'm going to actually get into drawing. So we're kind of opening up to questions while I'm drawing. All I'm going to be doing today is I'm going to be cleaning up this drawing, because before I even bring it into traditional, I like having a pretty good foundation that I do digitally, so that I'm not struggling during the traditional part of like erasing and then editing. And I want to make sure that when I do the true flip, because I'm only going to be drawing half of this traditionally, and then I'm going to scan it and flip it digitally so that it matches all up. But I want to make sure that it's perfect in Procreate before I even print it out on like a 2% opacity on an actual Strathmore sketch page, and then I'll pencil it from there. So I'm going to be doing a little cleanup work. Let's see, what's this? Okay. So yeah, if you guys have any questions, definitely pass them along, and then we will do our best to answer them while I'm working on this. And really quick, to those who are wondering what brushes I'm using, I am working with a 6B pencil brush. It's not a custom one. It's one that's built into the brush library. And I just work at 100% opacity, I believe. Yep. And I usually work pretty small. All right. Now I'm officially done.
Okay. Jen says, hello from Denmark. For some reason, the stream was paused before it started, so I missed the first 18 minutes. Oh, I'm sorry to hear. I know sometimes it will do that. Not all the time, but I've done it where I watched Tim's streams when I'm not on them, and it'll sometimes not auto play. It'll just sit there still.
Wait, really?
Yeah, I don't know why. I don't know why it does it.
Well, that's weird.
Amy said, some great advice I heard was that marketing was customer service. You are telling your customers what you made and providing them a way to get it. It made me feel less bad about views, likes.
Oh. Yeah, that's a good way to look at it.
Turkey says, the background looks cozy.
Oh. This is Josh. Yeah. We officially got a green screen, and then obviously this isn't real. We're going to be looking at different things that we can do with it. This is our standard one that we're going to start off with, and then hopefully play with some fun animations and things along the way.
It's really cozy, though.
It's very cozy. It's
immersive. Erica L. Illustration says, not a question. I just love seeing you and Josh. You both look so happy whenever I see you together. On your art takes my breath away. Oh, well, thank
We're
you.
We're very good at acting.
Professionals, one might say.
Right.
I mean, we do want to do a pancake video sometime, you're talking. Because I know Pancake Sunday is like, Tim says it's a thing. You see all the messages.
So I always post every Sunday when Josh makes pancakes, and he started this tradition of doing pancakes every Sunday.
It was during a convention that we hosted. Not we didn't host the convention, but we had people stay at our house for a convention in the area. And it was that weekend. It was the MKEE. Yeah. I think it was the 2021, right before everything went crazy.
Yep. Yeah.
So it's been, we're going on almost...
But the thing is, everyone always asks me on Instagram what the recipe is. And I'm like, I actually don't know what the recipe of Josh is. Or Josh knows. But he wants to perfect it before he gives it out. So I feel bad every Sunday basically telling people, no. So we're planning on eventually doing a live stream where Josh will not only give the recipe, but we'll do it live. And it'll be like a fun... we'll do it on a Sunday sometime. I assume actually in the next month or two.
You can draw. I'll make some pancakes.
I think it would be cute if I drew... pancakes, or if I did like a little dirt kid with a maple leaf and then had him pouring syrup. Right, that'd be cute.
I love that.
So if that intrigues you at all, that's what we're doing sometime later this month.
I claim the original for that one.
Yes.
Felix says the mother from Coraline. Only being nice to manipulate people into self-harming behavior is the ultimate villainy.
She was a good one.
I like that movie. We've not watched that one again.
No, I watched it. I watched all the Laika ones again recently. It was like earlier this year or last year.
I watched, well, because you showed me the one I didn't see, the Missing Norman. Link. No, Paranorman.
Oh, Paranorman, I literally think it's cute. Excellent.
That one I didn't see before.
Yeah, Missing Link was okay. No, I did not care for Missing Link. I love Laika. Did not care for that movie, though.
Jen says, I'm pretty sure that Sephiroth is an anime villain.
I mean, yes.
What about the... What's his name from Yu-Gi-Oh? He's the other one with the
Pegasus?
Long hair. Pegasus, yes.
Pegasus is pretty good. Hated that he lost right away, but... Spoiler.
I know, I wanted more Pegasus.
Same.
Josh Andrew says, do you have a favorite project that you're working on?
Good question. I guess I'm working on the three, so Tarot, Mermaid Deck, and Aquatica Nautica. Favorite of the three? I would say they are all lining pretty even. Oh, look at Astrid on top of the boxes.
How did she even get up there?
Magic.
How did she get up
there? I will say, recently I've really enjoyed working on the 5-foot epic. That's what I'm calling Aquatica Nautica. I had such an intimidation with it last year. I like maybe put in 7 to 10 hours total the entire year. And already I'm at 6 or 7. 6, I think. And
are you still tallying as you go?
Yeah.
Oh, you are. Okay, good.
Yeah. So every day when I do my hour, I have this little tally board next to it. And I have a different marker so I know which month and year I did it. And it started in 2019, technically, but I'm only like 45 hour, 46. And then every 20 hours, I do a video for my Patreon backers to kind of explain what I'm working on, what changed in the last 20 hours, the little stories that I'm creating. Yeah, the first two are actually on YouTube because I make all my pre-recorded videos exclusive to my Patreon backers for 3 months, and then I'll post them publicly after that. So the first two were actually done so long ago that they're now public on YouTube. But the new video should be up actually later this month because I'll definitely pass, or if not later this month, early February, because I'll definitely pass the 6G hour mark soon in the coming weeks.
Oh, yeah. And speaking of storytelling, although I didn't try to even, because I know you're a walker, not a talker.
Yep. Don't even say it.
I'm going to say it.
Okay, fine. But if you say it, you are verbally committing to this. And whoever's in the chat right now, you can definitely hold Josh to this.
Candid camera. But we are talking about doing our little music once again, where I'll make a little piano song and then Tim does a drawing to it. Because we did the little snowflake collector and then the little troll with the wind chimes.
Mm-hmm. And both those are on YouTube now, too.
Yeah, those are on YouTube. So I think we'll do more of those. Because those are fun. It's a fun way for me to... do something collab like with you. So
Well, I know something that I definitely want to do with you is I've been replaying Final Fantasy X again, and it's my favorite game of all time. And I was telling Josh I would love to do a collab with him of two Xanarkand, and then I know how to play the original melody, but then Josh is really good at adding decorative, like, what's that called when you go up or down a piano?
Scales. I have to brush up on my music theory. I don't
I
know all
know,
the
isn't there's, I
terminology,
think there's a
but
name for like going to
I call it like scale climbing. I don't know
yeah,
though. Yeah.
but Josh is really good at adding those kind of decorative elements. So we're gonna have our own little cover of To Xanarkand. Once again, that will probably be a February thing too.
Yeah. Well, we're getting finally we have well, it was your mom's, right? The one
Yes,
upstairs?
yeah.
Yeah. It's got to be what, 30 years old now? How old is that piano?
Older than that, because we had it before I was born. I'm 32, so at least
It's
35, 40 years.
just a really pretty old wooden stand-up piano. It's just really pretty, and it's been out of tune, well, since I moved in, so that was 3 years ago. So finally we have a piano tuner coming to fix the sustain pedal, get the everything tuned and sounding good. Because I mean, I think digital keyboards are such a cool thing now that we have, but I still like the feeling and the sound that a actual piano makes. It's got such a The bass sounds good. It just has a good sound to it. So we can practice on that, translate it to the keyboard, and then we can record it. So that'll be fun.
Yeah.
Or we could eventually try to record through the piano, which would be nice.
We could try. I feel like it's definitely cleaner
We'd
to
have to
do
get
it
a better
digitally.
mic too.
Yeah.
They have the boom ones you put inside the piano. Like you put them inside of the thing and it does it.
Oh.
Yeah. Femme says, pancake Sunday recipe book, please. Definitely something you would want to do, but
We've talked
that
about
one
it.
not gonna make any promises about yet. Cause I don't want to be a talker.
Well, you don't have to start if you're already walking that talk.
Of those people that if he talks about something, you know he's just gonna do it. And I have a habit sometimes of talking about things I want to do,
Yeah,
but I
how's your daily
don't.
crocheting going?
It's gonna start up again soon. Also, I still have Tim's birthday blanket from September I need to finish. That's why I not didn't make a career out of crocheting because I knew I would not make it.
Thankfully, you're a great person because it's definitely
At
not reliable with what you say you're gonna
least I
do.
got that going for me.
To those wondering really quick, when I'm looking at my underdrawing, I'm trying to find the best lines and then I'm trying to make them as strong and as minimal as possible. So when I go into the pencil, I have these very strong outlines that I can work from. So anyways.
Well, just for anyone new too, so you do this step and then you'll actually work traditionally after doing this. This
So
is your base layer.
yeah, so when I print it out, and it's kind of hard to explain, but when I print it out, you'll only see. Let me make this way bigger. Okay, so the parts that I'm blacking out right now, I will not be drawing. So basically this. And then I'll actually draw the tail down here. Imagine that. This will be blacked out. So it's weird. When you do a true flip, you only draw half of it if you're doing it the way that I'm doing it. Right, and then all of this will not be drawn. And then this will be drawn. So it kind of confusing, but the only thing that I'll be printing out. Or no, I will be drawing that part. Is just him with all this like empty negative space, essentially. And the reason for that is then when you draw just that, you scan it, and then in Photoshop, you copy paste and literally rotate it 180 degrees. And if you did your lining up right, it should match like a puzzle piece and it should snap like right together. So that is what I did with the original deck, and that's what I'm hoping to do with this deck. But when I print it out to be worked on traditionally, I print it out literally at like 2 or 3%. So like just light enough that I can see it, but you would never really know that there was anything there because it's so light. It's really just a foundation for me to build on top of.
Thank you. Your art made me stop crying.
Oh.
Oh.
Well, I'm glad it made you stop crying. I hope it didn't, like, make you laugh, though. Like, ugh.
You've heard of the draw-along stream. Now get ready for a bake-along stream with Josh.
Yeah.
We definitely will do it.
I think that would be a fun thing to do.
Hang on. We got the blue screen.
Oh.
I'm definitely next week. We already have the thing coming in the mail.
First.
To not have to deal with this anymore.
So apparently this is a problem that ScreenLink has, but Josh has a video capture card. Do you call it? I don't know what it's called.
Yeah, just a game capture.
But apparently he can make it work.
With the iPad.
And there we go.
It's back.
I mean, not the worst thing to have to fix on the fly, honestly.
At least it's quick. You don't have to unplug anything or do anything too crazy. Inyo says, draw a happy chibi Josh making huge pancakes. That would be cute.
That would not be too hard, honestly. I'm sure a lot of you guys have this too, where I have to be careful when I zoom in digitally. Because then I get so wrapped up into how it looks close up, but then when you pull back, it looks like hot garbage. So I have to be careful every time I do any type of digital work. And I know that it's funny because I was a digital art teacher for a while, and like the true thing that you should do is try to stay zoomed out as long as you can, and then only zoom in when you feel it's absolutely necessary, which apparently is right now.
Completely necessary right there.
Right. I kind of like the idea of him being like this. He's definitely masculine, but I definitely like the idea of like flowers in his hair, so like full hippie. And then, oh, it's blue screening again.
This is just happening.
First stream of 2022. It's already broken.
All right.
Throw it in the trash.
There's always next week. It's coming back.
That's so strange that it does that.
I don't know why it's doing that.
Especially, I mean, this isn't even like a free app. We actually paid for the app. I don't know why it would be messing up.
Next week should be a lot better with that.
I guess then you'll have to just be on charge of watching it to make sure it doesn't do that again.
Well, it's weird because it'll last for a while, and then it just randomly, like that time, then it only lasted 30 seconds.
Yeah, that was nothing.
Very strange.
Definitely gonna do some of the. I really like doing hair curls, kind of like how you see those curlers for girls with long hair. I guess guys with long hair too. Or it creates this kind of like spirally effect. Definitely gonna use that for a lot of the underwater mer people that I'm gonna be creating.
Felix says glissando for the piano thing. Maybe that's what it's called. Oh. I have to brush up on my... I actually have books coming in the mail this week because I want to start kind of brushing up on my music theory again.
Oh, is that the especially going up and down?
Yeah. Well, especially with reading sheet music. I've been playing by ear for so long now again, and I just really miss... I want to play by sheet music too, because just picking up sheet music, you can... If you can pick that up, you can just play anything then.
Yeah.
New Moon Sin says, is this being recorded on a tablet? It's Tim's iPad. Yeah. It was just weird because we're so used to using a Mac for streaming, so that connects with the iPad really easily. Where now we're using a PC, so it's a little different.
A little different. Probably put some kind of underwater flower in his hair there. One there. So whenever I do like quick sketches of flowers, they'll be like this scribbly mess, but I'll kind of understand what they're supposed to look like. I have to move his arm up. I want him like also putting one in his hair. This is why Liquify is super nice. But as with any tool like this, or even in Photoshop, the same thing, Liquify, be careful not to overuse it. And it was something that actually Miles talks about, is keeping your eye sharp. And that's why he doesn't do tracing when he does his transition over traditional. Because if you rely too much on these little... Oop. Forgot that my iPad I got to put in the airplane mode as well. Oh, geez. Top right. How do I do this?
Top right.
There we go. Wait, will that block the... I guess we'll find out. All right, we're good.
That was really risky.
That was super risky.
You could have done do not disturb, but we're good. Do you have any... Well, Yaskar says, do you have good tips on how to capture detail when drawing eyes in a smaller scale, since you really can't zoom in without working digitally?
That's been something I've been learning with my 5-foot drawing upstairs, is the mermaids are literally like the size of my thumb, and their heads are literally smaller than my nail on my pinky. So their eyes, at first I try to like really draw where you can see the different opening and the flap and the eyelashes and the actual iris and stuff, but it just doesn't translate well. And I think with scaling down so small, you have to really simplify it. So there's this one video, oh gosh, I can't remember who did it, but they talk about how when they paint, they literally will squint their eyes.
You're on Wi-Fi. I think that's why it's doing that.
Even though it's on airplane?
Yeah, because you're on Wi-Fi, though. There.
Oh. The more you know. Nope. My cousins want to play a board game with me so bad that it is demanding to go through. How do we... Do I turn off Wi-Fi?
Mm-mm. No, I think we... I think we need that.
I guess you guys get to see my full conversations with my younger cousins. Okay. What were we even talking about?
We're talking about eye detailing.
Oh, yeah.
On a small scale.
So when you scale down so small, basically, if this was their head... when I'm zooming in, I'll like give the eye pocket for the hollow area under the eyebrow to like the top of the cheekbone. And then like this would be the cheekbone area. And when I draw the eye.
Wish.
Let me see if it actually comes up.
It does.
That's so bad. We'll figure it out for next week. I'll just tell them. Actually, you know what's funny? Really quick. My whole family knows I stream on Wednesdays from 12 to 2. My mom, every week, will call me at like 1:30 on a Wednesday. I'm like, Mom, I've been doing this for so long. How do you not realize that it's Wednesday at the time slot? But anyways, when I draw their eyes so small, I'll give the allude to the different features without fully drawing them. Here, let me get it full on screen there. Yeah, Josh, you got to be more... because I'll just sometimes zoom in and out, but I forget that the screen's not capturing
it. I'm just here relaxed with my tea right now. Oh, yeah, the stream. What do you want me to do? I'll tell you when it's off.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. So then I'll go in back with my eraser then and kind of erase some of the lines. But I really will keep it very simple. And then when you zoom out, it'll give the impression of a face without actually fully detailing it. So I'm learning a lot with scale. With
I dare
my...
you to keep that in there?
Absolutely not.
Just this random head just floating in the water.
Absolutely not. I'm learning a lot through working on my 5-foot drawing because so much of the detail is small, and I feel really strong when it's larger. But it was funny. I posted it in the Discord earlier today, but it was this quick clip of Ian McCaig, who did like the concept art for Star Wars. He's really famous for Darth Maul. But he talked about if you're afraid of something in your work, that's the direction you need to be heading in. If you're most afraid of it, that's exactly the next step you should be taking. And I think that's why I've been enjoying the Aquatica Nautica so much recently, is because it's challenging me. And I'm realizing that, yeah, there's going to be things that I'm just not naturally good at right away. And I'm more in a position now to try to attack it and get better. Where I think all of last year, I was definitely trying to play more out of a comfort zone. And I think a year of doing that can really mess with you, because it can mess your sense of being an artist and a lot of the, what's that called when you feel like you don't belong? It's a complex? The oh my gosh, Josh.
This is part of the bingo thing, is us trying to find the word for something.
Not identity complex. Oh my gosh. I'm sure one of you guys will know what I'm talking
complex,
about.
Complex.
No, it's like you...
I actually have no idea what you're talking about.
Where like you feel like you're tricking people into thinking you're good, or like that you shouldn't actually be where you are.
Fake it till you make it?
No, no, no. Someone in the chat will get it, I'm sure.
Okay. That's why we just need the chat up every day.
He looks a little too mischievous here. Also, his eyes are way off. See, with traditional, you'd have to erase and then edit, erase, edit. Once again, I'm not saying digital is easier, even though it definitely is. But this is how you can get too reliant on Liquify to help move and push and pull things, where I do like training my eye to be able to do this kind of stuff without any type of help.
Felix says, that's why I do more traditional nowadays. It forces you to simplify shades, values, and color. Being able to pick any color, zoom, layer mode, liquify can become a crutch and overwhelm you with options.
Yep.
Imposter syndrome?
Imposter syndrome. Who said it?
New Moon Sins 1.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You all got it.
Everyone got it, though.
Inferiority complex.
Ooh, Corey.
Hello, Corey. Corey's also one of our wonderful mods. Oh, along with Ella. Well, hello. Hello. Yes. So imposter syndrome is basically when you feel like you're tricking people when you're in a position that you feel you don't feel valid to be holding. So a lot of people feel
this. But it's
not
deliberately tricking, though.
No. It's not malicious intention, but you just feel like you don't belong. Or like if you got highly praised for something, but you only thought you were like subpar good, you feel like an imposter because you're like, I shouldn't be receiving this amount of praise.
Oh, gotcha.
You know? Also, something digital that is like one of the best things you can do is literally flipping it horizontal to see your features.
Do you need help, Astrid? She's on top of these boxes. They're like floor to ceiling piles of boxes we have set up right now.
Yeah, do you want to help her really quick?
Oh, poor baby. Astrid, it's okay. I'm coming. I'm coming over, honey.
Oh, she's like, oh, no, I got it. As soon as Josh gets up to go help her, she's like, oh, no, I'm just playing. I just wanted attention.
What she does to me.
And now, things like the features I don't have to make super perfect digitally because I'll rework them quite a bit traditionally and make sure that they fit what I need from them.
Alex says, nah, use the tools you got.
No, I'm gonna argue that. I do think keeping your eye sharp, well, it's weird because if you're primarily a digital artist, like I guess technically Alex is primarily a digital artist. No, even then still, Alex, I do believe like you should try to avoid using Liquify as much as possible because I think in the long run it'll save you time. Where, like, if I felt more confident right now in drawing this face, I wouldn't have had to even use Liquify at all because my initial placements of it would have been so strong. You know, but since I know I have that crutch of digital, I'm now using it. And I probably would work faster if I didn't have that option even at all.
Esther has not been leaving me alone. She's always around. Is she? Come here.
Hey, usually she's more like Miss Independent.
Oh, goodness.
I think this is throwing her off. She doesn't know what we're doing.
I think the food, because I'm transitioning her food still. But wait, Astrid's still? Weird because, yeah, it's been over a month right now. I don't know. So I mix Astrid's old food with this new food I'm trying to give to her, but she will eat individual, like the kibble, she'll eat each one individually and leave the new ones out. It's a little crazy.
I mean, sounds like her.
I mean, I kind of, it's a very patient thing to do, but same token, Astrid, you gotta try the new food out. Ella says, I've been working in Clip Studio Paint for most of last year before it had Liquify, which it got in December, I believe. And although it's definitely not necessary, I'm still happy that I can use it now and again.
It's a super valuable tool.
I mean, yeah, you just...
Like, I don't want to dog on it too hard because it's very valuable. But I think if you're an artist that does a lot of character and human proportion stuff, one, I think the best training tool to start off with would go do life drawing. I'm trying, as soon as it opens up again in Wisconsin, I will be the first one in line because I can tell my anatomy has gotten a little soft over the past 2 years and I'd like to, you know, sharpen it. And I think especially doing traditional anatomy studies at life drawing, not bringing an iPad or a tablet, because then you see your marks being made and then you have to either work with the mistakes or you become more aware of when you do mistakes and how to correct them on the fly.
There's got to be some life drawing stuff open now, right?
I would hope so. What is she doing?
I don't know. She's just... She wants attention right now.
I don't think we're going to give you attention. I'm sorry.
Askar says, so since it's so small, you have to simplify with your lines. This is in regards to the eyes from earlier. But what features do you think are the most important to outline? What should be pushed and what should be vague?
Definitely like harsh lighting values, like cheekbones and things, like the undershading on it. I would really simplify the value to the point where it just kind of shows the features with like maybe a hint of shading. It depends on like the clarity that you want with it. Like if you really want it to read the entire face, you're going to want as minimal as details as possible and like just focus on the under part of the nose, under the eyes, and then maybe under the lip and like the top lip. It's like the areas that would be the most in the shadow. But if you're trying to do it more vague, I mean, I've seen artists that do paintings where there's like a crowd of people and in the background, they're literally like 4 or 5 paint strokes or brush strokes. So it all just depends on the level of clarity you're also looking for on a piece that's small. And that's something I'm really looking forward, or that's where I'm learning with the 5 foot drawing is I'm still figuring out where that balance is. And I think that's why I've been pushing the struggle of super detailed faces and very vague ones. And I got to find a happy medium.
I'm in the middle of a stream right now, Astrid.
Hi, baby.
I'm immediately trying to stream. Oh, sweetie.
Uh-oh.
Hi. Astrid.
She doing?
Oh my goodness. Oh, Astrid. What a weirdo.
Love her.
Astrid. Well, she'll just chill out there.
Yeah, she's fine.
Astrid, you distracted me. New Moon Sin says, why is the Liquify option useful? I also use Clip Studio Paint. Also, Q-Kitty.
So it helps with like minor adjustments quickly. And why that can be so helpful is like if his head, let's say it was like here, you could tell just looking at it, his shoulder is way too far. His trap is way too long for what it would make sense. Even if I was doing like a stylized proportioning of a character, this wouldn't make sense because then his left side is really squunched and short. So Liquify can help you basically push it into a position that feels more natural and you don't have to erase and adjust everything. Because if you were doing this traditional, it would be a lot of erasing work, a lot of redoing. But since it's digital, you can just literally push it. What could be like a 5 to 10 second fix digitally would be like a 30 minute fix traditionally. And that's why Liquify is so helpful as a digital tool, but why, and I'm almost saying this too, because I definitely had a problem with overusing Liquify and relying on it too much. Because then you really aren't relying on your personal marksmanship skills on when you put down the strokes and the lines. You just throw down anything and then you just pull back and then liquify it to it. But then if someone asked you to do like a human proportion quickly or like draw a sketch, you might get lucky. But more often than not, especially in my case, I was definitely off when I was leaning too heavily on my digital tools than I was my traditional. And I think it's a beautiful tool, but it's one that just don't get too fixated on it.
Astrid's just sitting on the table right now.
Actually, I'm okay with this. You want to sit there?
She's like, just draw me.
So I might start adding little more aquatic touches. Like I did this on my Tristan drawing where he has like some of the scales coming from under the arm, through the armpit, and then down the side of the body. And the thing that I want to do with the clubs, well, one, I want some of this like transparency, which will be way easier to show with my pencils. So I want all these fins to have some of that transparency to it. Hey, baby girl.
Hey.
You want to sit there? Okay, you can sit there.
Good. Trying to see. Esther has a habit of licking fur off her. And I feel like I see a little spot. We'll see.
Do you?
See it like on her side? Right there. Oh, now she's looking. It's when she looks up, you can kind of see it. Astrid. All right. Time to catch up on these comments.
Yes.
Alex says, oh, I don't use Liquify, but the end result is kind of the goal. So if you know what it's supposed to look like, then your eye is all good. The merit to be traditionally or technically sound or correct can get in the way of your creativity, in my opinion.
Tim?
I would love to have a full-on debate with you on this. Because there's definitely something about keeping your eye sharp and your mark making where, oof. You know what? Actually, Alex, I would actually do, like, bring you on and we could have a debate on this specifically. Because I think it would be good for, because I don't necessarily think you're wrong, but I don't think you're putting in perspective of how it can damage you as an artist by over-relying on a tool like Liquify specifically. It would be like, for a lot of you who know what Wumbo, or is it? Yeah, Wumbo art. Where imagine if my backgrounds, rather than painting scenery, I would just go to Wumbo, type in a image generated piece, use that as my background, and then paint over it. I'm no longer utilizing my skills. I'm just using a tool that's been available to me, but I'm not really using my skill set, you know? Like, that's the difference between using tools to benefit you and then relying on them, which can, I think, hurt you in the long run. It would be a good debate, though, I must say. For those of you who don't know, Alex Dos Diaz is one of my closest friends now. And him and I really connect because I think we both have very strong opinions and views on things. But we also are very good at recognizing each other's counter-arguments. And we're not dismissive, but we definitely won't back down. And I think something else that's good about friendships like this one is he's not just a yes man either. And I think people need this in their life too, where they're surrounded by people that will challenge them. And I think me and Alex do that all the time.
Clearly.
Clearly. But I almost need it. Like, I like it because then it keeps me, it makes me look at what I believe in. And then when I speak it out loud, it challenges the idea of, wait, do I believe in this? Like, do I have a sound argument as to what I believe? And yes, there are times where like, no, I think there have been times where it's like, no, I actually think I'm wrong. But for this one, I don't know. That's why I'd love to debate you.
Gotta debate.
Right? I think we need healthy debate back
Can I be the debate moderator?
Yeah. You can be like Tim? The timer with your glasses. Okay, Tim.
Tim, you gotta give Alex a minute here at least.
You've gone over your 2 minute timeline.
Tim. Oh my gosh.
What?
That'd be fun.
Oh yes, right.
Let's see.
So hard to see.
I know, I almost need to make that full screen. Emery. Oh no, it shows up right there. It actually updates on this one compared to the other one.
Oh, yeah. That's nice.
Emery, thank you so much for subscribing. Oh, we don't have the bell.
No, it's okay. I feel like that bell was a little loud.
That's like 50% of why I'm here, Tim.
Subscriber bell.
Oh, Jonathan's here. Excuse my late entry.
Hello, Jonathan. How are you doing? Jonathan, how's the end of the year? I feel like it's been a while since we've interacted.
How's Scotland
treating you? Well, that was a terrible accent. I apologize in retrospective. I thought I could. I went for it and then immediately receded on it.
Let's see. I don't want to miss people's comments. Oh, Felix says, I live in a small village now. I would have to travel to Berlin or Potsdam for life drawing. I still can do the promo stuff from home, though. There's got to be probably some online life drawing things they do, right? I would think, especially with COVID right now, I feel like within their limits of what they're allowed to do, depending where it's at, I would think
there's life drawing. Loki, that's another hot take. I personally believe you should do it in person, if you can. I mean, obviously, if you're in a situation like yours, Felix, yeah, I would definitely do online stuff because that's the only thing available to you, really. But I do think there is a difference in doing a life drawing session online. Even the ones that we've done, they're good, for sure. But I think being in person and seeing the body breathe and the changes and, like, the subtle nuances that you might not be able to get through a photograph. I know there's some life drawing stuff where they'll actually do a real model and, like, video for, like, an hour or something, and then, you know, you draw her based on that video. But I do think being in person and then understanding the scale and how the light's hitting, I personally believe it's better in person. But that's another one of those hot takes that, Alex, another thing we can debate on. I don't know if you're on the other side of this or not.
Hang on, I'm just taking a picture of Astrid right now. This is so cute.
Yeah, Astrid, post it on the Discord.
Astrid.
Hi, baby.
You're so cute. I love you, Astrid. Oh, she's very distracted.
She just wants to be a part of the stream.
Yeah.
Hey, baby. Are you falling asleep right on the corner of the desk? Okay.
Let's see. I will put it in the stream follow along. Just Astrid chilling.
So something I'm very aware of doing while I'm doing contrast stuff like this is where a tail or where a body part or something intersects with another one, or like overlaps, I should say, I'll definitely make one darker and like really punch the contrast to give it that value shift. And it really makes the different subject matter areas stand out from one another. So in this case, the bottom of his tail here, sorry, the T, I don't like want to cough, but I can't. There we go. The bottom of the tail here, I'm going to make really light in value compared to the darker end of the tail here. And then same with here, I'm going to make sure that this part of the tail remains kind of that lighter value. And even if this isn't as dark, it's slowly transitioning down, getting darker. Can you see that? Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
There. Yeah.
That's good. Sorry.
You don't even have to look at this. I know the temptation's strong.
What if I go? I can close. Never mind. I could technically close the webcam off for a second if needed. Here. That way, then you can show what you're doing without worrying.
Oh, and then something else that I'm trying to do is whenever I do a little, I don't even know what these are called, side fins? Little, I don't even know what they're called. The ones that come off of the tail. I'm always doing, for the club suit, it's going to be three circular fins, kind of like these flowy fin things. Also, once again, to kind of match the club shape. So I really want each of the mermaids to represent their suit without it being super obvious. So I want some of it to feel more nuanced, but if you really take the time to look throughout it, you'll pick up more and more of where I'm hiding the shape of the clubs.
We back.
Oh, did it blue screen?
No. Oh. No, I just put the webcam away and then the fireplace stopped working.
Oh. You just saw the green for a second?
It was just us with the white background, yeah.
Oh, with a white one? Yeah. Oh, because it eliminates.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, it was see-through, so you could actually see the iPad screen. Oh my gosh.
So Astrid's literally falling asleep on the table, but like sitting up.
Oh.
Astrid, how is that even possibly remotely comfortable for you?
There we go.
So I'm not exactly sure on what type of jewelry I want him to be wearing. I feel like I might do that during the pencil part. This is something that me and our other friend, Sean, talk about, where I like pieces to grow organically. So I'm okay being like, okay, I know when I do the pencil part, I want there to be some kind of a jewelry pendant around him. But I don't know what that looks like, but I'll just figure it out when I do the pencil stuff. Where he has this thing where he'll draw everything almost exactly how it's going to look when it's translated into pencil. And it's definitely a different way of doing things. And we talk about the benefits of doing both. Because sometimes my struggle is I'll be like, okay, well, I'll just figure out what the necklace will be when it's traditional. But then when I go into the traditional process, I'll have to like redo it over and over and over again if it's not, you know, just locking in right away. Where for Sean, he'll lock it in for sure and it'll be exactly what he wants, but it'll take way longer in the digital phase. So it's also interesting learning that every artist has a different method of creating their stuff, and every single one is valid in its own way, and one isn't necessarily better than the other. I think there are things that you can point out, like I think mine can be more time efficient, yes, but mine also comes with way more mistake management that you have to deal with in the pencil phase. And then figuring out like what type of an artist you are. If you're a traditional one, do you even like starting on the iPad? Maybe that's like an absolute no for you, and you just like to get straight into traditional. And I get that too, because not all my drawings start digitally. I would say like a fourth of them start digitally. Usually it's when I'm doing like project-based stuff. So since this is a card deck project, I need everything to fit a specific way to match the theme and every piece to be coherent with one another.
Yeah, because if you started this one without your parameters kind of for the card, mm-hmm. traditionally, it'd probably take a lot of editing afterwards to get it.
Oh, this would be a nightmare.
Set up, right?
Yeah, if I didn't have Procreate to help with the lining up the flip, I don't think I would even do a card deck, to be honest.
Yeah, that'd be difficult.
It would just be a lot of lining things up and a lot of technicalities that I'm usually not super into that side of art making. I like the very organic free flow of creating art. And I think this is the extent of like being technical for me as I can go. It's like the limit that I'm willing to go for my work.
All right, let's do some catch up though.
Catch up.
Oyaskar says, do you have any tips on how to get better at drawing different textures? Is it just about collecting references, or is there a better way to study or practice?
Oh, different textures. Oh, definitely practice. When I was doing CG Cookie, practice on the four basic forms, which are cube, sphere, cone, cylinder. If you can shade a material on all four of those, you can shade it on literally everything, because all four of those shapes or forms are found in everything. So even with like my mermaid, technically you could see the shoulder cap as a sphere, which then leads into a cylinder, followed by another cylinder, you know, and then you're just adding the details to mold it and, you know, mesh it along the way. But for the most part, everything can be broken down into those four forms. And when I was doing material studies with CG Cookie, I would do things like slime and then do it in those four forms. And then you really want to focus on, you know, there's so many elements with that where like light can pass through. So you have to worry about subsurface scattering. And then within slime, there might be little bubbles. And depending on how close they are to the surface, you'll get different transparencies to that as well that you can see from the outside looking in. And then there'll be other ones like wood texture. Light cannot pass almost at all. So you're going to get very starch bark, and you want to create the illusion of that in like the little divots. I think the biggest thing with different textures and materials are focusing on how it reacts to lighting. That's the number one. And then two, the surface texture. Is it smooth or bumpy? Because there's a big difference between, let's say, a metal sphere, which is reflective. I'm trying to think of a highly reflective. And then like a sphere that's made up of glitter or something. With the smooth one, you're gonna, or not glitter, let's just say a metal ball that's like has scratches all over it. On both of them, yeah, they're both the same material, but the surface texture is different. So the smooth one will have the perfect gradation of light hitting where the highlight will go, and then it'll pill shade out. But then on the scratchy one, everywhere where you see a divot and a scratch, there should be a little highlight where it's facing the source of the light, and it'll create this more jagged looking appearance on it. So lighting material or materials and surface are a great thing to study, and that's something I would definitely encourage, especially if you're getting better and learning it for yourself. Also, I just want to note, I'm having him hold a wreath, and that's going to be one of the things that are interconnecting between the two forms. I don't know exactly what flowers are going to be in the wreath. This is where I want to do more research. Actually, if any of you know, in the Indian Ocean, the most popular foliage or sea life that's more plant-based, I would love to know. I'm definitely going to add my own little, the berries. I don't know, I might even look up if there's anything underwater that kind of represents that as well. But I would love this to be some kind of a kelpie wreath that all have these three leaf prongs on them. And then I'll just go around, kind of like that.
Ella says, also sometimes I like to just play around with liquify and push the anatomy and movement in the piece. And afterwards, when I have a basis, it's easier to draw on a new layer on top.
Wait, say the first part?
Ella says,
oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yes. Which is kind of like what I'm talking about for just starting out. I wouldn't recommend liquify or like tools that make it easier, because I think you're still learning the foundations of like where proportions are and where the anatomy goes. And yeah, like for someone like myself, I guess it would be, maybe this is what Alex was talking about, it'd be more viable for me to be using it because I have learned. But I do think every time I rely on it more and more, I get a little weaker in how sharp my eye is seeing the things. And that's something that I don't want to completely upheave my knowledge and understanding of anatomy.
I guess the only thing I could relate to with it is when I was doing the Drawtober stuff and I was using GarageBand, it was so weird for me to see that you could actually change the tempo. So you could actually record something and change the tempo of it. You could do tempo correction. So if like you're playing off tempo a little bit, it'll correct it for you.
Oh.
You yeah. can even change the time measure. I could see how people could start relying too much on that. Where when you play, you almost might be like, this could sound better if I could change
to a quick edit. It's weird because then I guess this conversation leads into a lot of automation, and how much are we allowing that into our, not only our lives, but in our skill sets.
I feel like that's in so many different aspects too.
It's everything. Even think of like basket weaving. You could have someone that weaves baskets by hand, and yeah, they're definitely going to be a better basket weaver than someone that just uses a machine that they bought to weave the entire basket for them. But technically, they're the ones that programmed the type of stitch and basket they wanted, which is still work. But the actual labor, the doing of the process is easier.
I think there's still, I think people...
This is a way bigger conversation than I think we can have on just this mermaid card stream, because I think it leads to a lot of different questions of where's the line, where do we draw it for ourselves and for our industry of where we don't see it as like their own anymore. I know that when I go to shows, I definitely get conversations a lot at my booth of like, oh my gosh, this is all traditional. And then they'll talk to me for a while about how refreshing it is and blah, blah, blah. And even though in my mind, I'm like, you know, I did teach digital for 7 years and I do have a lot of digital paintings. And I know that they're not trying to be insulting, but I do think there is this level of wow factor when people find out that you've done something traditional over digital nowadays, because people assume that digital just means easy or like shortcuts. And that's something that I was taught in school too. Because when we had to do our graphic design course, we only could use a Micron pen. We weren't allowed to do anything digitally. And if you even made like one error outside of a box or like a little pen, like even if it was like, so like, let's say this was the box. If I did like a stroke like that anywhere, I would go from an A to a B immediately.
Oh, geez.
And that's how they graded every project. So it was a very strict, very demanding process. But by doing so, I felt like I became stronger with the way that I do line weighting 100%. And I don't know. I don't know where this conference, I would love to have a bunch of people on this for like a debate, not even like a full debate, like just a good discussion, because this is obviously a more opinionated debate. I don't think there is a right or wrong answer. So everything that even I'm saying, you could totally disagree with me, and that's totally valid too, you know? So yeah, I guess that's my thoughts on it. But yeah, the piano thing is a great example too.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, where is my... Wait, I lost my iPad. Oh no, it's just behind. There we go.
It'll sometimes lag or something like that. Yeah, I think the plugging it in through the capture card will make it a lot smoother.
I think so too.
Alex says make a list.
Oh, of things to debate on? Automation. That's going to be our first one.
Felix says, I used to plan my oil paintings digitally a lot more, but it's way more fun to experiment on a real canvas. Colors never work out the same as digitally anyways.
That's very true. And there's so many conversations about this that I want to have. Because even with like oil painting, I think about how back in the day, the masters would literally mix their own colors. And that's something that we don't even have to do anymore. And
well, I mean,
there's this whole debate of like, does that mean they're better because they had to mix their own colors? Or do they have, I would say they definitely have a better knowledge of it, 100%. I don't think that's even debatable. But does it mean they're better? No. But I do think they have a higher knowledge of it. So they have a keen eye on seeing if they needed to make a part of their piece a little more of like a, not a neutral gray of like a, what are the famous oil painting colors? See, I never oil paint, but I remember like burnt cyan. I think that's one of them. Is that one of them? They would know how, what they would need to mix to get that color. But digitally, you would just pick it and you just drop it on. And I think skipping that process, is it valuable? I think it's a very person to person, it would differ. I would say it is valuable, but obviously I would know Alex would say it's not valuable or it doesn't add anything. And both aren't wrong, you know?
Yeah, there's not really right or wrong with that. That is purely just your opinion on it.
Because this goes into... Okay, there's a much deeper debate. And I think why Alex wants this one, too, is because we've had debates within our own friend group of the whole digital versus traditional thing. And I will always stand my ground with, I do think traditional is harder than digital in almost every aspect. And I got into kind of a tiff with Deandra about this one day too, because she doesn't think that it matters. And I'm like, well, it doesn't matter to you, but that doesn't matter to, it doesn't mean that the general public sees both as the same. You might see both as the same because you're an artist, and that's fair. But I think when I think of what goes into here's a big thing. So there have been people that do Procreate drawings where they download a pencil tool and they make it look like pencil, and they'll throw a sketchbook page overlay or multiply layer, and it looks like a traditional pencil drawing. And there have been a couple of times where it actually tricked me. That's how good technology has gotten now. And the big thing I always say is, when you find out that it's digital and not traditional, what is the feeling that you have? Because that defines how you feel about it. Because for me, I was like, I cringed, and I was like, I instantly lost respect for it. And it's not anything to do with them as a person, nothing against the piece, but because I know how much easier it is to like draw digitally with a pencil tool than it is with a real pencil, I lost a little bit of the wow factor. Because if there was anything that was super symmetrical or in proportion or anything, it could have just been a quick liquify. But if I would have known they did the entire thing in pencil, to me, that's far more impressive. Because then that shows any mistake that they had along the way, they had to correct it manually, which can take so long. I need to preface all of this, though. This is very person to person. What I say is not, you know, gold and standard for everyone to think this way. That's just my personal beliefs on it.
It's your opinion. I mean, I think a lot of it probably is because you work traditionally, so you have more respect for it personally.
Probably.
Yeah, and that's probably the base of a lot of it for you.
Well, I think because a lot of people are trying to make things look traditional now when they're actually digital, it's just a weird thing for me. I'm like, well, why? You know? But like I said, this is something that we could actually have a legit debate. And I'd love to have Alex on because he's primarily digital, and I think this would be a good back and forth.
Alex says, added to the list. Also, the masters had years to make paintings, when we get weeks, maybe months. Not today, it is not valuable, but it was advanced technology at the time, so it makes sense.
But then wouldn't you say that those are restrictions and constraints that we put on ourselves, that we have to do them within weeks and not years?
I think that comes back to, though, too, when you're making art a career, it does change, though, the fact that you have to work quicker. I think there's probably hobby artists out there that we don't even know of that actually still do that stuff and really take their time with it.
Well, ones that are even well-known. Look at Annie Stagg, Gerard.
Does she actually mix her oils?
She doesn't mix them, but she does all oil and has been for quite a while. You know, she could easily transition to digital. I've seen her do some digital stuff. I think one of the only people that seems to be really pulling off the traditional digital mix is Justin Gerard. Because you can tell it's digital, but you can tell it's traditional as well. Because he does a lot of his stuff traditionally first. He'll scan it and then finish it digital with color. Okay. And it kind of pulls both worlds together, which I actually do find that kind of beautiful because of the way he melds it. And it's not like one's pretending to be an oil painting, and it's not like one's pretending to be digital. Although it'd be super hard to make something look digital, traditional, unless it was more graphic-based. But then here's the other question, too, to follow up on it. Like I said, if anyone thinks that me and Alex are fighting, this is how we talk all the time. With my giant 5-foot drawing, I think the reason why I haven't wanted to work on it is because I've been so conditioned by the modern era of doing art, where I feel the need to constantly be posting and constantly be finishing things. And there's like a weekly quota that I feel I used to have to make. I have to at least have one new drawing every week. And for a while it was two. I used to try to do two new drawings every week. And it met the Instagram machine, and I was having fun with it, so I didn't actually completely hate it. But I did feel the pressure, 100%. But was that a pressure I was putting on myself? Is it pressure that society is putting on me? A lot of it I do feel was self-induced, but that is a good debate too, is has art changed because of the way that people view it? And the way that people consume it now, does that alter the way that we make it? And I think that answer would definitely be yes. But the real debate is it for better or for worse? Because the better would be online world platform.
Alex.
Oh, does he have more to add to this?
No, he says we got to talk about this because I got opinions. No, it's industry and social, more opinions. I say we drop this.
No, I love
it for
this.
You and Alex. I think in person would be better then, too, because then Alex can share his opinions on it right away then, too.
Actually, you know what we could do? Because, Alex, I'm pretty sure you're doing Anime Milwaukee in February, and he's staying with us. Why don't we plan, and you could be the moderator, the debate moderator.
We should get Melinda to come, too.
Just have just a huge out, like, debate brawl on art. Well, because I think there's a lot of even younger artists or even people that might be watching this either now or after the stream ends that they might disagree with me on some things, they might agree with Alex on some things, and there might be a lot of in-between where I think it's good to have discussions like this.
Are because... you team Alex or team Tim?
Well, like, we'll have shirts that will just say team, team T, and his will say team A.
What if I walked in with a team Alex shirt on?
I would say that's a very valid.
Oh my god.
I would ask for your opinion on what do you believe he is right on. Well, that's the thing about debate nowadays, where I feel like this is definitely socially influenced, is debates now are very much like, I'm right, you're wrong, and I'm going to just basically shout at you for 2 hours until I get my opinion so far down your throat that you can't help but swallow it. Where what happened to, like, actual back and forth debates, where it would be like discussions where even if it was like opposing views, there was a respect level between both sides and you could have a conversation without it becoming name calling and basically reduced to things that aren't even about the subject at hand. So I'm down for it. Alex, if you're down for it, I would love to do it. Let's make shirts. Josh, I would be okay if you wore a Team Alex shirt if you agreed with him on these things more than my views on things.
I'm gonna play it safe and just be team neutral.
Oh boy. Well, you might as well get...
Moderators can't have opinions. They have to stay...
Actually, it's true.
...middle ground.
Yeah.
I gotta do some catching up, though.
All right, catch up.
I skipped a couple to keep...
Oh, because we're trying to keep the streams now to 2 to 2.5 hours. So they'll probably be a little longer than they used to be. Just because I don't think I'm that fast of an artist. I've had people tell me that, but I actually don't think I am, especially for streams. So we're going to try to make these a little longer. And especially because I ramble. I tend to ramble.
Yes.
I do. I do. I really do.
Ella gets your humor. Tim, I think that's very valid of you, Josh. And also your things are outside the door.
What?
Ella said, Tim, I think that's very valid of you, Josh, and also your things are outside the door. But there was actually a message up here I thought was funny.
What is it?
Wait, let's see. I have my old reminder thing, and I know I think I remember your name.
Oh, Jim. Lights and See?
That's Jim, yes, Jim.
Yeah.
I was like, I have my little list.
How are you doing?
I've not been in streams for probably, what, six to seven months?
Yeah, roughly.
Jim, good to see you. Actually, you recommended the Lord of the Rings artist. Hi, simply for the sake of asking, do you prefer drawing really, really, really ridiculously good-looking people aside from Halloween? You don't seem to draw ugly people.
This would be something I'd like to explore internally, I guess. I haven't questioned it as much.
When you're hot stuff.
No.
Okay,
you guys got to hear me out on this. I grew up feeling like I've always been like a 6 out of 10 in terms of looks. And as a kid, I think that's why I turned to other things because I never was vain. I never felt like I was good looking. I never got attention of the girls at the time. Obviously not the boys because I wasn't out yet. And I was just kind of like comfortable with it. I was okay not really getting attention for how I looked. And then you go through your whole life not getting attention for how you look. And you honestly, it forced me to not care about the way I look. I'm actually not scared of getting old. I'm not scared of getting wrinkles and gray hair and everything because I've never been able to rely on it anyways. Why would I start relying it on in my 30s, 40s, 50s? But when I draw people, I think I'm very influenced by the way that Tetsuya Nomura drew characters. And I kind of have the Final Fantasy effect where they all have a very similar look to them. And...
Hey, baby.
You want me to pick you up, and then you don't want me to pick you up. So I'm very confused right now. What do you truly want, Esther? Who are you?
She's like, I just want to be popular.
Hey, baby.
Oh.
And in the art world, it's called same face syndrome. And I definitely think I'm a part of it. But I think I've just embraced it because I like when I can tell that it's a character that I've drawn. Same with the way that Lo draws her characters. Or like when I see any of Annie's characters, I know immediately they're hers. Even if it was just in the line art. Because of the way that she does her eyes and her nose, they're very much like an Annie signature. So when I look at the way that people are drawn, I think that there's a signature behind them. So I think, I don't know if I'm just justifying why I do this, but to me, all my characters look very similar. And it's just like my stamp of how I draw people. And I like drawing noses with like a little undershade. They're nothing too crazy. I like to add shading on either side of the nose like this, usually some freckles. The eyes are usually lighter. I do a lot of the Kingdom Hearts double iris, where it's like two lines within. And then I kind of do these eyebrows that are thicker. And it's just something that I enjoy these facial features in characters that I've seen growing up. And I think it's just now bled into the way I do art now. So, yes, I guess I am just kind of justifying why I do it. I should explore other features, yes, and still be able to have like a stamp to them. So yeah, I guess that's something I should explore more and still be able to create a character where you can tell that I drew it.
Hi, Astrid. I mean, you do that with swordplay, like Grizzy and stuff too. I feel like they're not traditionally,
yeah,
I guess, attractive, kind of. But I don't know, you add the story and they feel, I don't know. You definitely do experiment with that.
I would say I definitely cater, or not cater, but I definitely stay in this lane more for the way that I draw people. Because to me, the most fun parts aren't really this area. The more fun parts are like this. Like this, I'll have so much fun shading with a pencil. Where a face, it's like, yeah, it's there, you know. And I think it can add story elements. But, yeah. I don't know if that answered the question fully.
Neo says, can you please speak about the things you mentioned in your captions recently about how sometimes you are unmotivated or feel like you are not on the right path or in the right path?
Yeah, so kind of going back to how I was feeling in December, certainly was there was such a disconnect. I had a disassociation with, there's a lot of things going on behind the scenes that even with like the art world and specifically even our art crew, I would say 2020 really like shattered this bond that a lot of us had, and there were a lot of us, and then there were so many events that were like pulling people in different directions that eventually everyone felt like they were on their own island. And then bleeding into 2021, we started picking up the pieces, and it would be like one by one you'd kind of find people that you would relate to. Alex was one of them, and it was kind of sad because this big community that you felt a part of now felt like you were, you know, finding other outcasts or other people that you felt you could connect with. And I think I was doing that with my art as well, because I was having such a hard time just connecting in general. And then my art, I put this huge barrier of not really putting myself within it because I wasn't comfortable showing it. And what are you trying to do?
I'm just watching.
I keep seeing you do things on the side.
Astrid will cover up your face.
Oh, just basically Astrid talking.
Yeah.
I mean, this is fine. This is fine.
You're fine.
But this is where I'm going to bleed this into why a schedule is so important. And maybe you're one of those people that need this as well. So I don't do well without a schedule, I found out. I need some kind of structure in my life, and I feel happier. I feel motivated. And I'm one of those people who, if I get done at like 5 o'clock and I know I've put in a certain amount of hours for the day, I feel like then the rest of the day I can do whatever I want and not feel guilty. I think there's a lot of times artists can guilt themselves if they didn't do a lot of work that day. And when I didn't have a schedule, it would just be like, well, I could do this, but also the house needs cleaning over here. Like something needs to be done. I would distract myself with things that were easier. And now that I'm kind of out of it, I look back and I realize one of the schedules I had was too difficult. It was like a 8-hour schedule where I had 8 different projects. It was way too many.
That was a lot.
And I was trying to hop from one to the next smoothly, which I realized I can't do 8 at a time. Even though I feel all powerful and I try to do self-talk, motivating, that kind of stuff, I'm human. I can only do so much. And I'm recognizing where my personal boundaries are. And right now, I can't even work on swordplay, which is my illustrated novel, until I get this mermaid deck done, the tarot deck done, and this aquatica nautica 5-foot piece done. And then I feel like I can fully dive into swordplay. But if I have these lingering projects in the background, I feel like I'll never fully jump in the pool that is the story and world I want to create for swordplay. So this is kind of like my final push before jumping into that. And if that's something that you might need to hear, try doing it like an hour spurt during your day. So right now I have 3 hours that are dedicated to my tarot, my mermaid, and the aquatica nautica piece. And then every morning me and Josh are in the other basement doing the 2 hours of packing, shipping, answering emails.
We do our workout.
And we do it well. We've done 2. I don't want to make it sound like we're committing to this yet because
just
we didn't do it before.
A little bit. Okay, we've been working out.
We've been working out nonstop. We're gonna get so swole. And I have an hour timer that I'll literally, before each one, I'll set it. I'll do an hour worth on that project. And then I give myself a 20-minute break after each one so that I can either, like, go make food or go clean something or do something where I don't feel like I'm destroying one of my hour time sets. So Josh has seen me do it for the last two-ish weeks.
I know the holidays kind of messed a lot with it, but...
Yeah, and I personally felt so much better because I felt like I've been able to connect again with my art. And a lot of it was through not only setting a schedule again, but also finding out what's important to you in your work and what do you want to say with it. For me, I realized it's storytelling and relationships. So I think you have to first ask yourself that question, even before setting a schedule, honestly. But if you don't know the answer to that question, that's okay, because for a year I lost that answer. And I was just creating without really a destination in mind. So, anyways, I'm rambling. We can go on to the next. Esther, are you just going to sit there the whole rest of the stream?
She's just chilling.
We should just put a little Astrid bed, like, right here.
I know, she's being so clingy lately. I like it, though. I'm not complaining. It's just...
It's weird for her. She's usually Miss Independent.
I'm
kind of surprised
by
this.
She's like, I don't need to deal with you humans. I just don't want to miss anyone.
All right, catch up.
I just don't want to miss anyone. Oh, Felix says, I'm super slow on the tablet for now. Being able to zoom in, you lose track of time. Artistic color selector in Krita is amazing, though.
That's what I hear about Krita. And, I mean, I haven't been doing the best job of it on the stream, but try to stay zoomed out more if you find that you're wasting too much time zoomed in. I definitely do that with my color illustration pieces that I do digitally. I'll literally get to, like, here and then just paint for an hour on just, like,
this section. Oh, my God. And then you zoom out and you're like, oops.
Then you zoom out, you're like, oh, that doesn't even match the color theme that I'm going with.
Well, then if you're doing it so detailed on that spot, you'd have to do it the same everywhere then.
Mm-hmm.
Oh gosh.
Because unless if you're doing like what is that called, detail contrast, where like you heavily shade the face but then everywhere else is kind of blurry or whatever, you better make sure that if you're heavily shading like a non-specific important non-important area, then you kind of have to do the rest of it to that level of render.
Interested. Jim says, definitely can tell with him drawing. You have a distinct whimsical style and character. And because it's usually monochrome with the lighter eyes, your characters almost have this statuesque luminescence to them.
I will admit, I love the way a marble statue looks, even with their face. Even though it like looks slightly unrealistic, I kind of love that. And I do think I've slowly integrated that into the way I do my pencil drawings. And that's why I think their eyes I keep so faded looking. It's because I love the way that marble statues have that same look.
Oh, that reminds me of, was that in the Bahamas we did that? The snorkeling?
The statue that was under the water.
Yeah, we went snorkeling and got to see, they had these giant underwater statues that were built there. And I forgot the reason they were there.
I don't remember either.
That there were these statues in the ocean, just on the ocean floor. They were huge. And it was cool because you could snorkel around them and you felt so small compared to this massive statue.
Oh, piece of advice if you are doing your own card deck, you don't have to draw the jack and the pip on the left side on every single card. I learned that some of mine would be slightly different from one another, which is fine. It adds kind of a touch of originality. But I realized like they were slightly off on each one. And I'm going to do just one really good set on like a separate piece of paper of jack, queen, king of each suit, and then just copy paste on each one to help with consistency.
Felix says, I don't understand how styles work. I don't think I have a very specific style, but some people tell me it's still very recognizable. Well, then I think you definitely have a style if people can recognize it.
You might not be aware of it yet. The what?
I said that was a Schwab opinion, but yeah. I think if people can recognize it, that shows that you do have a style, but you, like you were saying though,
yeah,
probably just can't.
You might not be able to, like, if other people are able to see it and they're not just yes men being like, oh yeah, you definitely have a style. Like, you gotta make sure you have friends that will tell you the honest truth if you need it. But if you trust these friends and they're telling you you have a style, then you probably do have a style. You just haven't taken a constructive look at your stuff probably in a while. Let me get a little darker here. I mean, he's nearing done. I would say probably like 15 more minutes roughly, and then we'll cut the stream. So if you have any questions, now would be the time to ask, especially if you have any hot takes that we can discuss upon.
Jeez, who I missed. I know actually Corey wrote, I was never trained or taught with digital drawing tools, going back to digital. I've never gotten the hang of it fully. It feels like relearning to draw for me. I'm much worse at it. Some peers in school totally picked it up and ran, but it never clicked for me.
Well, that's the funny thing about digital as well, is there is a learning curve for digital too. I mean, not only are you learning, well, for me at the time, I was a tablet. So not only are you learning to draw down on nothing, but then look forward at what you're drawing. So you're not actually looking at where you're pushing. That was a weird learning curve. And then two, usually you have to learn a software, whether it's Photoshop or Procreate, Krita, any of the ones, you have to learn the menus and how to create new layers. And there's a lot to that too. So learning digital is very overwhelming at first. But once you get over that, I call it the 3-month hump. Once you get over the 3-month hump of learning a digital software, it's so nice because then you can move so much more efficiently throughout the piece and throughout the software getting what you want. Oh. She's on the other side of this wall.
Astrid?
She literally went to the other side of the basement and started clawing
she's
the wall.
Literally psycho. I don't know what she's doing right now.
Did you feed her?
Yeah, she has food in her bowl right now. It's full. No, I think she's just, she wants to go snuggle. She always wants a little afternoon cuddle. Because usually after, this is kind of after our normal work day over there. Sometimes I'll just sit on the couch for a second.
Oh, that's probably why. Though.
Yeah, it's become a part of her habits. I just realized Neil says I just realized Alex just went off
blue screen.
Just realized Alex Dos Diaz is on the chat. Yeah, I think it'll be fun to have Alex when, especially he's here for Anime Milwaukee. Alright, there we go.
Well, I know Alex was one of those friends I met at a workshop, what is that now, 2 years ago 3 2019, and I could tell that he had a similar view on how to work and like work ethic and the importance of it.
I don't know what I just did.
What are you doing?
I don't know. Okay, we're
good. We're good.
What did I just do?
I don't know. Oh, you probably changed the layer to one of the different modes.
Oh, okay. Yeah, look at it. That's what I did.
Yeah. Or that we might have clipped
weird.
It. And I think it's good to find people that have that similar view of working. Because I know I definitely work harder if I'm around other people that are pushing themselves. And specifically when it comes to the art friends, I think I had such a good group in college. It was like me, my close friend at the time, Nubia, and there were like 8 of us that were really battling each other. And it was like a very healthy competition in art. Angela was one of them. And we would just push each other to be better and better. And whenever one person would learn a new technique, they would teach everyone. And it was great to be like, oh, I just learned how to utilize the multiply layer on a pencil drawing. And we're like, what? How do you do it? Where I think having that type of energy around can really motivate you to push yourself in your own stuff. Where I think with COVID and really breaking up personally, seeing people, and I'm not the best at online interactions with staying in touch. I'm definitely more of a, I like to be in person talking with people. I lost a lot of that encouragement, a lot of that friend group that I had. And not that like I lost them, but we just didn't have it anymore like we used to. And I think for you guys, finding a group of like, not even a lot, like 3 to 5 artists that can help motivate you can just speak volumes in terms of helping motivate you and keeping you held accountable for what you say you're going to do as well. I mean, you probably have that with other things too. I probably should hold you more accountable to like the crocheting. And
I mean, that does help. But yeah, I don't know. Gaming? Hold me accountable to a game.
Yeah, I'll make sure you play your games.
I do that one on my own.
I don't need someone to hold me accountable for playing video games.
Alex says, Alex Hostias, aka the instigator. Hi.
Wait. Me or you? Oh, you.
No, towards, you know. Towards Alex Ostias being on the chat.
Yes.
Yeah. Also known as the instigator.
That'll be your title in the debate, Alex the Instigator. I'll have to figure out what mine is.
You guys need like opening cinematics too for each one.
Could you imagine? Okay, so the last thing I'm gonna do. Because I'll probably add more of these little flares throughout, these little like side things coming off of his tail. I really want to do a heavier black outline on a lot of the fin part. You know, some fish will have like that lining on the edge, and I'm going to do that throughout on him as well. Do you ever get that where you talk too much and then you have like so much air built up, it's like hard to talk?
I just don't talk a lot.
I was like, no, I've actually never experienced that once in my entire life. You know what? We should go to Subway today after this. Get the tradition back. Maybe it'll be back to the way it used to be. Subway kind of changed for us in the last
never gonna
6
be the
months.
Same.
I know. It went under new management, and they're not as nice as the old ones, and it's really sad.
Yeah, no offense to the new people. They're nice. It's just the old crew. Where the people
so
you'd walk in and they know your name.
They'd get your sub ready without even having to say.
We know about their life, so we'd ask them how it's going. I guess we just need to work on getting to know the new people.
That'll be our mission for today.
Yes. I'm still in my pajama bottoms.
I mean, same. As long as you look good from the waist up on camera, you're good. No one will see that you have Super Mario pajamas with my winter socks.
You match gorgeously.
Thank you. I really try to put effort into my wardrobe every day. Every single day.
No, you don't.
Wow.
But I like that. Gotta follow it up.
Gotta follow up.
But you don't. But that's what makes you charming.
Actually, I'm really excited. Josh and I are... Oh, yeah, Alex, I forgot to tell you guys. We're going to the Dells tomorrow. We're leaving We don't know exactly when, but there is a new, it's kind of like a fantasy themed escape room, and it's called Wizard Quest. And we did the old one, but they just built a brand new one, and we're going to be going. Friday, probably.
It's not open tomorrow, I checked.
We'll
have to go Friday.
But I'm so excited, guys. Literally, it's one of the best times I've ever had in my life. And considering that this was like a kind of made for children fantasy escape room, it's so good. They have the four different realms of fire, earth, water, air. And like the air one is actually above, like on the second story, and like bridges, and you have to get in these pods and spin yourself. And it's kind of like a giant I Spy mixed with escape room. So you have like an hour, hour and a half, depending on the challenge that you pick. And it's so good.
It's so good.
Because there'll be like secret rooms. There's one that connects the water and earth realm. And you don't even really need to find it. There's nothing in there really. But there's a, it's just blue with like a bunch of treasure chests. And the way that they lit it, there's this giant crustacean. This is a crawfish or is it a it's a lobster.
Lobster, yeah.
And he's just sitting on this chair with like a bunch of these gold pieces, and they only light it with like three blue lights, and it's so sparkly, and it feels like you're in a movie. I can't believe how well of a job they did. It didn't look like tacky fantasy, which sometimes in some of the other zones, some of it looks a little tacky.
I mean, I kind of like it sometimes, though.
Sometimes
it
gives you that 80s. It has a charm.
Sort of fantasy charm to it, yeah.
But overall, I would say like 80% of it's actually well done. And I think that's so surprising when everything feels so plastic and modern nowadays, which maybe that's for some of you guys, but for me, not really what I'm looking for. And to go to it, it's really magical. And the fact that they have built a new one and we haven't been there yet.
So. I'm kind of nervous.
Oh, I am so excited.
I'm excited, but also nervous just because
I hope they don't try to modernize it.
Well, because I grew up going to it. So, I mean, I've been going since I had to be, I think, open when I was like 10 or 11. So my family, we'd go every few years. So it's cute when, I don't know which cute one.
It'll be sad if they don't realize what was so great about it in the first place and they try to make it like new.
He says, I actually saw Josh's pants when he stood up. And I was like, wait a minute. Yeah, I got my little polar bear ones on right now. They kind of look like the Coca-Cola polar bear a little bit, but they're cozy. It's all professional up here and then all comfortable down there.
I mean, yeah.
Astrid, it's up to something.
Now, she's doing
like
something.
She's like meandering over there, but she's not really doing anything. She's just walking.
Tell you guys, it's not like our cat. She's usually very independent and not around us this much.
Ella says, me and some of my art friends created what we called a bullyvation list, which is a Google sheet where everyone will add their art to to-do list, and then we will push each other to get them done.
Ooh.
That's a good idea.
Wait, what was the first part?
A bullyvation list.
What's a bullyvation? What does that mean? Is that a made-up word? I'm assuming it is.
It's like a mix of, you can bully each other to get that stuff done.
Oh. Oh, I love that.
Actually, that's a good way to keep track. You should do that with your little group, too.
Right.
Just to know what everyone's working on, too. Because sometimes you can probably forget.
Because I would say, like, right now, our core... Well, I probably shouldn't name names. But within the core group, Alex is in it, so he knows.
We're everyone's close friends.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I would say within the core group, everyone's pretty self-motivated. But what's nice is I don't even really have to hold each other accountable. But just by showing up and like showing the new work, it's like you're holding each other accountable by just showing up and just kind of being who you are, which is really nice. Because I would say when I was much younger, like definitely high school, way different, where like none of my art friends were nearly as like crazy as I was in terms of like getting things done. And in grade school, we thought we were gonna make a video game, and there were like eight of us, so I would have tasks for people to do every week, and like there was only two people that would actually come through with their tasks. Nate actually was one of them, and
no surprise,
no one else like came up to that standard except for Cat kind of did. So it's kind of funny.
Had a list of people. No surprise. Some things just never change.
I think I'm just a very driven, obnoxious person.
You're task-oriented, though.
I'm very task-oriented.
Yeah. Which is, I think... I mean, I'm starting to find my love for it again. I just keep a to-do list going all the time.
But it's so funny because I consider myself such a hippie in a lot of other aspects that to be so rigid and having a structure, you would think would go against everything I am, but...
I think
they balance each other. I don't know why, but they do.
I mean, through all these, you have to get stuff done. So I think you are hippie in some ways, but I think you also have to get stuff done. So
I think maybe in like my lifestyle. Oh, you know what? This can go back to compartmentalizing things. My art life, very rigid and structured, ironically, even though it's like doing art. And then my personal life is more like hippie, go with the flow. Because even when like people want to come over, I'm like, yeah, just come over. Like, it's like very lack of structure.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Yeah, I would say art life, very structured. Personal life, non-structured.
That reef's really cool, though.
Oh, his tail?
Well, no, the reef in the middle.
Oh, that's
cool. Yeah.
I got to figure out
split for it. Although I think we maybe, I thought, hang on. This is something else I missed. It's one of those things I always take mental notes and I'm like, oh, I'm going to get back to that one.
Oh yeah. Catch up.
New Moon Sin says sea grapes could be nice for berries. So sea grapes are an option.
We'll have to Google sea grapes. Oh, yes.
Oh, those are cute. Whoa.
Oh, weird. They look like the fake plastic, not pearls, but the things that you would get at like a Hobby Lobby. Like beads. Oh, yeah. They look like beads.
They look like beads.
Wait, go all the way up, though. I liked all the way up, 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 up. Oh, wait. Click the X. Get out of here.
Which picture?
Up, up, up. What's that?
Sea grape flowering desktop plant.
Actually, could you post that in the Discord? I think that might be the shape or like the plant I go for. I'm hoping that's an underwater one. I'll have to do more research on these. Because apparently the sea grape, they're like little beady looking things, but then there's also this plant that I assume is part of it. We'll see. Oh, and then whenever I ever want to make anything look like it's underwater. Oh, wait, did I do this on a new layer? Oh, yeah. See the before and after, everyone? See how much of a difference the texture can give? Can you see that?
Yes.
So the other thing, just the little bubbles. Bubbles are so much fun to draw. I thought about it, though. It doesn't make too much sense to have a lot of bubbles because there's probably not a lot of air trapped down below unless if it's like above a trench or something or like a volcano or... Now, something where bubbles would constantly be coming out of, but I think bubbles add the nice effect of this is clearly underwater. See? Just a few little bubbles can go a long way.
Wait, you can... Oh, it's mic's working, guys. Make sure the mic was... It was, like, completely...
And then for the hand, I'll probably take a picture reference for the hand so I feel like I do it right. Because if I try to do it blind right now, I think it's too low. I think I need to actually lift the entire arm.
Oh, cool. Actually, a couple people have been posting what they've been working on during the stream, too.
Oh, yay. Okay.
Yeah.
This is part of what I wanted the streams to be, too, because sometimes it's just nice working while someone else is working, and knowing someone else is working might inspire you to work. So, yeah, please post what you're working on if you've been working while listening to Josh and I on the Discord down below. I can't tell if I want him, like, holding a flower. This is where I'm going to take a few different pictures. If I don't want him, like, putting it in or just, like, combing through his hair, I don't know. I got to figure that out. But I think for the most part, he is done.
Alice says, my goal is to become more like Tim in that regard. thingy with like keeping tasks going. No, actually, I want to become even better. Demon fish.
Good. I'm telling you guys, just try doing like an hour at a time to start off with, and you might be surprised with how helpful it can be.
Oh, this is name. You this read wrong. Your art style always inspired me, especially the way you make some parts more bold. Example, the silhouettes, and leave others more soft. I feel it adds a huge effect, highlighting details a lot.
Oh, thank you.
RGY says, quick question, but are all your cards done digitally?
No, they're all... Well, technically, I guess they would be like 5% digital, because basically when I'm done with this layer... I'll show you what I do. What is this? Oh, yeah. So this was the initial drawing before the stream, and then here was after. So what I'll take this, I'll print it literally at like 3% opacity. So you probably can't even see it too well on the screen. The only thing that it's really showing me, like I usually don't over detail like I did on the stream as much. And starting next week, I'll actually do the pencil start of drawing. So I'll probably do this, the Jack Clubs next week. So if you want to see me start to pencil it, and you'll see how light I print it, because when I have it this light, I'm literally only looking for like the big landmarks of the lines that I can then trace over with my pencil. But then a lot of the times what will happen is I kind of like the direction of some of my lines, but when I'm working pencil, I'll kind of shift and let it grow organically. So really, as much as it was fun to like heavy detail this today, I really only need like this.
It's lagging a little bit too. I feel bad.
Oh, sorry. As I'm like talking, it's a white screen.
I don't know if we reconnect it fast. It might be more.
I think when we have the video card, it'll be better.
It's going to be way better, yeah.
But, okay, when it's coming up right there now, this level of detail is kind of at the extent that I really need it, because I don't like relying on digital much at all. It's mostly just to line up the figure so that when I copy paste twist, it snaps together like a puzzle. Otherwise, I think I would be doing this entirely traditional, to be honest. But when Procreate has a feature like this that can help flip, mirror, rotate it, and you can see what the end result would look like. It's really nice to see if it reads well together. And like I said, this would be a nightmare to try to do traditionally without the help of that flip assist. Okay, but I think I'm going to leave it at that. So thank you guys so much for coming to the stream. We are going to be, like I said, this is the first of many 2022 streams that we're going to be doing this year. We're going to be definitely doing these through May and doing a different mermaid every week. And next week, I'll start with actually penciling him, and then we'll do probably the queen or king, and then the king. And then in February, we'll start with the next suit. So we'll keep doing that until May, and then I'll do some form of crowdsourcing. It might be Kickstarter, it might be Indiegogo. I'm still trying to figure out which one I want to lean towards. And it'll be kind of fun, because then you get to see the creation of every card along the way. And we'll be here to answer questions and have more of a connection with you guys again, because I think this is something that I was also missing. And I know what Josh definitely wanted to do.
Just really quick, too. That's been bothering me. Okay.
There we go. to do more. So, all right. Thank you so much for coming. And if you want to keep the conversation going, you can join the Discord below. And if you want to see more of the behind-the-scenes stuff, we have our Patreon that I post on daily. And... yeah, I think that's mostly everything. Yeah, I think we're good. All right. Take care, everyone. I hope we have a great start to 2022. I hope to give some of that energy that I'm like overconfident right now in my pursuit, because I'm just so happy to find like a purpose in my art again. And I hope to share that with you guys as well. As thank you, Josh, for helping mod and for setting this lovely fireplace motif up. And we'll be probably doing more with the green screen in future streams.
It's very
we'll see.
Cool,
all right.
Woo!
And lastly, thank you all for coming. I hope you have a great rest of the day, and hopefully we'll see you next week. All right, cool. Any last words?
No, love you all.